Hi, everybody. Welcome to Bone to Pick. I am Michael Davis, and we are coming to you today from Randolph, New Jersey, in the beautiful country home of the great Tom Bones Malone. Simply stated, Tom is one of the most successful brass players in the history of New York brass playing. He has been a member of the CBS Orchestra, The Late Show with David Letterman, for over 20 years. He is an original member of the Saturday Night Live band, and he served as the musical director for 4 years there. He's an original member of the Blues Brothers Band, and as a studio musician, he has recorded on over 1,000 records and CDs, 3,000 radio and television commercials, and 4,000 TV shows. As a solo artist, he's released 2 solo CDs. He is active worldwide as a clinician, and when I was preparing for this interview, I've been a friend of Tom's for many, many years, but I wanted to just do a little bit of preparation. I downloaded his bio, and I can honestly say it would be easier to name the artists he has not played with than those he has. It is a formidable and impressive list, to say the least. So first off, Tom, thank you so much for taking time out of your extremely busy schedule to spend some time today and talking about your career and your amazing life in music.
Oh, it's my pleasure, Mike.
All right.
And it's always a pleasure to hang out with Mike Davis, a world-class trombone player. Nobody plays better than this guy, so you're certainly my brother.
Oh, thank you. The feeling is mutual, and it's very, very kind of you to say. Let's jump right in on your early years and kind of reflect back on you getting started in music. I know you were born in Hawaii, grew up there a little bit, but a lot of your time in Mississippi. Maybe just talk about what drew you to music and what made you gravitate to the trombone.
Well, I was born in Honolulu. My father was a Pearl Harbor survivor, U.S. Navy pilot, and we lived a different place every year. We moved every year. I went to a different school every year. We went back to Hawaii when I was born, where I was born, and we moved to California and to Maryland and to Florida before my father retired when I was 11, and bought a farm in South Mississippi. Both my parents were born and raised in South Mississippi. So it was sort of like my parents coming home. But I started playing violin at the age of 5 in the Honolulu Youth Symphony. And I played violin till I was 10, and for some reason gave it up. When I was 11, I saw the marching band outside the window at the school in Mississippi, and I decided I wanted to play in the band. So, they announced at the school that anybody who was interested in playing in the band should come to the band hall on Thursday night. And the guy from the music store had all the instruments laid out there. So I picked up a trombone, and I could almost play it. My father asked how much it was, and he said, "We can't afford it." So as we're walking out, the band director grabs me and says, "Well, the school has a tuba, and it doesn't cost anything to play it." So I said, "Okay." So I started playing the tuba. I learned how to play the tuba and started playing in the marching band. Now, this was not a glamorous band. We're talking about a little town in South Mississippi with a population 819. The school was kindergarten through 12 in one school. So we had a 28-piece marching band, and there was usually 6 or 7 high school students in the band, and the rest were like from fourth grade on. Junior high and elementary school students. So the caliber of the music was not that difficult. Matter of fact, the marching band played the Bennett Band Book Number 1, and that was our entire repertoire. So I learned to play the tuba parts to this marching band music. The next year, we changed band directors, and the new band director was a trombone player, and he knew I was interested in playing the trombone. So he loaned me his trombone. You want to play trombone? He showed me where the positions were, and he says, "Go home and learn how to play this." So I did, and I learned to play the trombone parts in about 3 weeks. And I was still looking for some sort of musical challenge, and I didn't know very much about what was going on, but I was interested in it. So my little brother got a cornet, and when he wasn't playing it, I learned how to play the cornet. My first actual professional job was playing bugle at the Boy Scout camp when I was 13, and it was a great paying gig. It paid $5 a week and a tent and 3 meals a day in the mess hall, and I thought I was on top of the world. When I was 14, some guys came over to my house and said, "We're going to start a rock and roll band." There was a couple of guitar players and a drummer and a saxophone player. So I said, "Yeah." So they started setting up, and I got my trombone out, and they looked at me like I was crazy. This is 1961. And I said, what's up? And they said, you don't have trombones in rock and roll bands. And that was indeed true at the time in 1961. All you had was tenor saxes and maybe a baritone sax in rock and roll music. Very few bands even had trumpet. So I said, well, what am I supposed to play? And I didn't know anything about jazz or rock and roll or much of anything, really. And they said, you got to play saxophone. So my friend happened to have an alto and a tenor with him that night. And so that night he started teaching me how to play tenor sax. And I wanted to learn because I wanted to be in the band and, you know, get chicks and all the usual stuff that young musicians are into. We were doing gigs with that band in about a month. And we were playing stuff by Ray Charles, and we played early Beatles stuff, and whatever we could figure out. And we played in really sleazy places, really sleazy bars, and sock hops and stuff like that.
Wow, that is awesome. It's kind of gives some insight into your amazing ability to double, because it's like it was so, seems like it was so natural for you from early on. You're already playing trumpet and saxophone and trombone. That's
so I've been actually playing these trumpet and trombone and tuba and saxophone for 52 years.
Yeah, awesome. That's great stuff. Well, let's fast forward a little bit into your collegiate career. You went to the great North Texas State, one of the premier jazz programs anywhere in the world for the last 50 years at least. And I have my own story that I'd just like to share with everybody. When I was in high school, my dad was a jazz educator, and I was always go to Tower Records. Back then they had record stores, and we'd go, as we all know, and look at the LPs. And North Texas was the only college program that would put out their lab band records every year. And for those of you who don't know, at North Texas they have the bands. They call the 1 o'clock band, 2 o'clock, all the way down. So the top band is the 1 o'clock band because they meet at 1 o'clock. So the best players were in the 1 o'clock. And I looked at I guess it was around lab 1968, 69, something like that. And I looked, and the lead trombone player's name was Tom Malone. And Tom already had a very successful professional career at this point, so I knew his name very well. And then I looked down and I see, oh, Tom Malone is also playing lead trumpet in the 3 o'clock band. And that just blew my mind, and still blows my mind. It's like somebody who could do those two things. It's quite impressive. But at any rate, Tom, maybe you could share some of your thoughts and memories about that time. Of course, the great Leon Breeden was running the program, but maybe even more importantly, you were there with such great classmates all the way from Gary Grant and Lou Marini, who would, of course, be a lifelong professional colleague of yours. But maybe just talk about that. And I know you were already starting to do some arranging and contracting. It just seemed like a precursor to what your professional career would be. But anyway, any thoughts about that time in North Texas?
Well, when I was still in high school, I wanted to play something besides marches on the trombone. And so I went to the music store, and we were a poor farm family. We didn't really have a lot of money. So I saved up enough money to buy a record. And this was, believe it or not, you could go to the record store in 1962. You could go to the record store and listen to a record before you bought it. I know that's so hard to believe, some of you younger people, but I found this record called The Persuasive Trombone of Ruby Green. So I bought this record and I took it home, and that was literally the only record I had for about a year. And I just loved the way Ruby Green sounded, and I played along with him, and he didn't know it, but he was my teacher. I just imitated Ruby Green. All I want, and that's still my aspiration in my life, is to sound as good as Herbie Green.
Likewise.
And there was nobody around to tell me that, well, it was impossible or it was difficult. I was just sitting out in the farm by myself, trying to simulate this music. So I first went to college at University of Southern Mississippi in Hattiesburg for a couple of years, 65 to 67. In the spring of 67, the jazz band from University of Southern Mississippi went to the Mobile Jazz Festival. And we were playing some of my arrangements, and I had a couple of solos. The North Texas band was there with Lou Marini on saxophone. So I met Lou there, and I heard his band play, and he heard my band play, and he said, man, you should really transfer to North Texas next year. So I took his advice, and that was one of the best things that I think I ever did in my life, was to transfer to North Texas. Suddenly, you've got all these great musicians from all over the United States, and it was very competitive. But I've always thought, from an educational viewpoint, musically, that the caliber of musicians that you play with brings your own level up the higher the caliber of the people around you. And I had people to learn from, not so much formal study, but I listened to musicians playing next to me, mm-hmm. and I learned a lot. I was mm-hmm. always observant. That was my main way of learning how to play trumpet and trombone and saxophone, was just standing next to great players and observing very carefully and listening very carefully.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so now I'm at North Texas and I'm playing with Bruce Fowler, Gary Grant, Jay Saunders, Lou Marini, Jim Riggs, Dean Parks, Ed Sof, and a whole long list of great musicians.
Yeah, that's awesome. I think it's such... I echo everything you just said. I think when you're around those great musicians, your level just goes up, especially if you're doing like you just described. A very great piece of advice for all of us is always listening and checking out what's going on around you. That's when you can really improve. Formal study aside, I totally agree with you on that.
I didn't really take lessons because I was a psychology major. So these playing next to great musicians was my lesson.
Mm-hmm.
That was my study.
Mm. Yeah, indeed. Great words there. Well, following North Texas State, then you immediately started working. We were talking a little bit before the interview, and you could share some of the stories, but the likes of Woody Herman, Frank Zappa, Blood, Sweat, and Tears. But maybe you could talk a little bit about Woody's band, because I know there's, again, like so many great musicians, including Bill Chase and Bobby Burgess and Sal Nestico. But what was your time like on that band?
That was a great experience, and it was also a very sort of real world experience of being on the road and dealing with the day-to-day life. It's not glamorous. You do one-nighters and you ride on the bus and sometimes you check in every other day.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes you ride all night on the bus and get to town and check in at 6 or 7 in the morning and sleep during the day and then go do a gig and then you go back to the hotel and sleep and then ride the bus all day the next day. However, playing with people like Bob Burgess and Hal Crook, Sal Nestico, Ronnie Cuber, Harry Hall, John Madrid. These were really great musical experiences for me. Playing with Bob Burgess, the greatest lead trombone player of all time.
Yeah, well, indeed.
Irby and Bob Burgess were really close,
right?
Competition there of your two great players.
Yeah.
So, which reminds me, when I was at North Texas State, my senior year, Leon Breeden brought in Irby Green as a clinician.
Oh, that's great.
So now I'm on stage swapping fours with Irby Green. And this was just like too good to be true. Even today, I go out and do clinics and concerts with school bands just because of what Irby did to me.
Yeah, the impact.
I want to do that for young kids.
Yeah, that's awesome.
Yeah. I don't feel like I play that well, really, but now I have a lot of experience and I want to share that experience while I can.
Yeah. Well, I do think you play great and musicality that you bring in the wide range, which I think we'll talk about a little bit later in the interview, but so important and valuable for students to be able to tap into somebody with your range of expertise. And right around that time, you moved to New York and you were doing these gigs and then you decided to, maybe you could tell us what that move to New York was like and that first little bit of time in New York was, what that was like for you.
Well, I was actually doing a lot of professional work in the Dallas area. I was with Woody in the summer of 69 and I went back, the fall of 69, went back to North Texas to work on a master's degree in psychology. And there was a lot of different things that happened that semester, but on the spur of the moment, January 1970, I decided to move to New York, and I was just crashing on Bobby Burgess's floor. Yeah, I had no gigs, didn't know anybody, and it took you had to wait 6 months after you applied for your musician's union card before you could take a steady job.
Mm.
So I just practiced and did whatever I could. Bob Burgess was playing "Promises, Promises" on Broadway at the time, so I started subbing for him, but I was practicing at the apartment and the phone rang one night and this guy says, we need Bob Burgess to play at the Club Baron on 136th Street tonight with the Clark Terry Big Band. And I knew Bob Burgess wouldn't get home till 11:30 or so, and the gig started at 10. So I just said, he'll be there. And I showed up with my trombone. And I met some unbelievable musicians there. Frank West, Frank Foster, Dave Bargeron, Howard Johnson, Charles Sullivan, Victor Paz, Dizzy Gillespie came by and sat in.
Wow.
Rhythm section was Bob Crenshaw and Mickey Roker. So this was, and Clark Terry, of course, the brilliant Clark Terry, this was just blew my mind. You know, suddenly, here I am in New York playing with all the best guys in the world. It wasn't that glamorous. I scuffled around and picked up whatever jobs I could. And one night, Bob Burgess and I were at Jim and Andy's, and he introduced me to a guy named Bob Pearson, who was a tenor sax player who had played with Woody. And Bob says, this kid is a good trombone player. This kid is a good trombone player and bass trombone player. And when he said bass trombone, this guy's eyes lit up. And I gave him my phone number. He called me the next day and hired me to play at the Waldorf Astoria 6 nights a week, playing 2 shows a night. They had a house band that played dance music for, they were there for an entire 6 hours. I just came in and played bass trombone on 2 shows that were about an hour long. But it was quite a good band. Jerry Dodgen on lead alto. Bob Milliken on lead trumpet. Mm. Youssef Lateef on tenor flute.
Wow. That's awesome.
Yeah. Joe Timperley on baritone sax. Quentin Butter Jackson from Duke Ellington's band. It was just an amazing gig, and I couldn't believe it. We did basically Las Vegas type acts like Johnny Mathis, Sonny and Cher. A lot of really good written orchestrations. So that turned out to be quite a fun gig. Well, Alan Raff got my name somehow and started sending me in to sub for him. Alan Raff was quite busy, mm-hmm. professional bass trombone player at the time. We're talking about the fall of 1970. So he would send me in to sub for him on Broadway shows when he would take recordings. And he would take every job that he was offered. And the night before, he would sort out which one he wanted to do, and he'd call me to do the other one. and if he had 3 gigs, he would call Vinnie Fanuel, who was a student of his at the time,
sure,
who was
sure.
also quite a good bass trombone player.
Sure.
So suddenly I was on the recording scene. I remember one of Alan's throwaway gigs was Turn the Beat Around by Vicki Sue Robinson. So now I'm in circulation. And I had also started playing with a band called Ten Wheel Drive in 1971, which was a rock band with 5 horns.
Right.
It was 3 trumpets, trombone, and Barry sax. And about the same time, I met up with Bill Watrous. And Bill really wanted to play in a rock and roll band at the time. Mm. And Bill and I became friends. We started hanging out. And I'd go over to his house, and we would practice together. And he really wanted to play in Ten Wheel Drive, but there was only 1 trombone chair. So I said, well, why don't you play in the band, and I'll play trumpet. And so Bill and I, from that point on, Bill and I were best of friends, and we are still best of friends. So Bill started sending me in to sub for him on recording sessions. And that's kind of the way I got involved in the recording scene in New York.
Wow, that's awesome. Amazingly fruitful time for New York, too. Just hearing and just the fact that you could run into Youssef Lateef at the Waldorf Astoria, like, it's like amazing, you know, to think of what was going on at that time and just the variety of musicians you'd see in the different situations, musical situations.
Well, Youssef and I hung out quite a bit, actually. I enrolled in the fall of 1970, I enrolled in graduate school in psychology at the New School.
Oh, wow. Okay.
Yeah. And Youssef was working on a PhD in philosophy at the time. So we would get together and go to, we were all both vegetarians, so we would get together and go to the macrobiotic restaurants in the East Village after school, you know, between school and the gig at the Waldorf. And so I ended up getting to know him quite well, and he was quite an impressive man, not just musically.
Yeah, sounds like it. Interesting. Well, as we fast forward a couple of years, in 1975, you were tapped to join the, at that time, a very revolutionary comedy show, which became known as Saturday Night Live. You held down the trombone chair for about 10 years. You served as musical director for 4 years. I think we could do an entire interview just on your years at Saturday Night Live, I'm sure. But can you just talk as much as you'd like and about whatever you'd like to talk about what the experience was like being on Saturday Night Live and being with all those great actors and actresses at the time. And the band, too, was amazing. But just what it was like being a part of that amazing show and what those experiences were like.
Well, it actually all started when, I guess it was around, I'm thinking it was around 1971 or 72. I have to do a little math. A trumpet player named Hannibal Marvin Peterson, who was at North Texas State, a jazz trumpet player, came up to New York, and now he's crashing on my floor. And he was playing with Rahsaan Roland Kirk, and he started also playing with Gil Evans. And one night he had two gigs, the gig with Gil Evans didn't pay any money. So he sent me in to sub for him on trumpet at the West Best Cabaret with the Gil Evans Orchestra. It was Gil Evans' 60th birthday that particular day.
Mm, wow.
And so I met several people who changed the rest of my life that night. Lou Soloff, Dave Bargeron, Howard Johnson, Bruce Ditmus, David Horowitz, Billy Harper, David Sanborn. Howard Johnson was asked to put a horn section together for Saturday Night Live, and he suggested me. Mm. Howard liked me because I played tuba and I played a bunch of different instruments. Howard, as you know, Howard Johnson, legendary musician, plays baritone sax, tuba, trumpet, bass clarinet, you know, plays a whole bunch of instruments too. So Howard and I instantly got together, and we played together with Gil Evans for 15 years. But Howard recommended me for the original band at Saturday Night Live. And I ended up, the original tenor player somehow didn't work out, and I ended up recommending Lou Marini, who came in about the fifth or sixth show and did the rest of the run of that show. I had a great time on that show. I became the arranger along with Paul Schaefer. I met Paul Schaefer at the beginning of Saturday Night Live, and we became the arranging team for the show. It was wild and crazy back then. I don't think the show is quite what it used to be now, but back in those days, there was a lot of creativity and a lot of talent.
Yeah.
And playing music was a lot of fun. It was a long work day on Saturday. We got there at 11 a.m. and we worked until 1 a.m.
So it was just limited to that one day. You wouldn't do, I mean, I'm sure you did some pre-production.
Sometimes we did pre-records on Friday night also, but it was pretty much everything usually happened on that one day. And it was a long day, and we did two entire shows. We did a dress rehearsal with an entire audience before the air show, and it was indeed live. It was not, they had tape running, but it was actually broadcast live. What you saw was what was going on between 11:30 and 1. I remember the first show too, October 3rd, 1975. The stage manager, Joe Dixo, he's counting down the show. He says, 2 minutes to air. And I'm thinking to myself, wow, there's going to be 15 million people watching this show. This is going to be exciting. 1 minute to air. What if I miss a note? Oh my God, 15 million people are going to hear me. So frankly, I got a little nervous at that point. 10. 9, 8, 7. But I got through the first show, and things got much easier after that. And now, 4,200 live TV shows later, it's no big deal.
That is awesome, yeah. Born out of Saturday Night Live was the band that came to be known as the Blues Brothers. And you shared the story earlier. I kind of thought your nickname came from the Blues Brothers, but in fact it didn't, but it maybe kind of became to everybody's consciousness, it became aware of it at that point. But of course, you're working with the great John Belushi and Dan Aykroyd, and maybe just talk about what it was like as that band started, and then it became obviously a very successful entity on its own outside of Saturday Night Live. But what was that?
Well, like? The Blues Brothers almost didn't get started at all. Here's the real story. John and Danny went to San Francisco one weekend, and they hung out with a harmonica player named Curtis Salgado. He was a harmonica player with the it was a blues harmonica player that played with a blues band, and they stayed up all night and listened to blues records. So on the airplane coming back to New York the next day, John and Danny started talking about developing some characters based on the blues. Now, John was from Chicago, but he was sort of a rock garage drummer. That was his musical interest, and he didn't really know about the blues, even though the blues are closely associated with Chicago. Sure. However, Dan Aykroyd was involved in the blues scene in Toronto, and he played harmonica, and he knew all the Delta blues musicians, and he knew a lot about the history of blues. So he started explaining all this to John, and they came up with these two characters. So I get a call from the music director, Howard Shore, and he says, can you meet with Danny and John in their office? And they started telling me about these two characters that were orphans, and they were, sort of had flat emotional responses to everything. One guy was fat and one guy was skinny, but they wore the same size suit. So it looked equally absurd on both of them. And so as they're developing the characters, they started working out dance steps and stuff like that. So what do you want from me, guys? And they said, well, we need an arrangement of Rocket 88 by James Cotton. So I found this obscure record and wrote an arrangement for the Saturday Night Live band, and we rehearsed the song. And we did it for Lorne Michaels. And we didn't make the show. But not to be discouraged, Danny and John continued to develop these characters, and so they asked me to write an arrangement of Hey Bartender. So this is the second week of the blues, pitching the Blues Brothers for the show. We did Hey Bartender for the for Lorne Michaels, and he said, frankly, I don't see anything funny about the Blues Brothers. So Danny and John were a bit discouraged. The third week in a row, we did not present anything. After read-through, Lorne Michaels is tearing his hair out saying, the show's 3 minutes short. What are we going to do? John and Danny jumped on him and said, Lorne, the Blues Brothers. And so as if to say, well, we've got nothing worthwhile to put in the 3 minutes. We might as well let you guys make fools of yourselves. He says, okay, the Blues Brothers are on the show, but if the show runs long, we're going to cut you. Well, the show did not run long. The Blues Brothers appeared and did the song Hey Bartender. And apparently the viewing audience thought that the Blues Brothers were entertaining, because we got a lot of telephone calls and letters and cards from the viewing audience expressing their pleasure with the Blues Brothers. So we ended up playing again. Before you know it, we had a record deal with Atlantic Records. And before you know it, we were doing a movie for Universal Pictures. So it turned into something huge, and it almost never got off the ground.
Wow. That is amazing. Yeah, I mean, that movie, you stop anybody on the street now. It's like, I mean, you must get that all the time. Even though you're on TV every night, people still like, Tom Bones from the movie.
Well, John Belushi told me that he was going to make me the most famous trombone player since Jimmy Dorsey. And I never had the heart to tell him that Jimmy Dorsey was the saxophone player of the Dorsey Brothers. But anyway, I knew what he was going for.
Yeah, I think he
meant well.
I think he achieved it. But just one first name difference.
Did not hurt my career.
No, that is fantastic. Well, in 1993, you were reunited with Paul Shaffer and Will Lee, who you worked with on Saturday Night Live, and you joined the CBS Orchestra, The Late Show with David Letterman. Now it's over 20 years, and you said it was the 4,000th show?
4,000th show on CBS yesterday.
Yesterday. So yes. Clearly it has legs, and it's been doing amazing work for so many years now. What has that experience been like? What's David Letterman like? How would you compare it and contrast it to the Saturday Night Live experience?
Well, it actually goes way back. When I was a music director at Saturday Night Live from 81 to 85, and in 1982, I got a call from a lady named Liz Anderson. And she says she was my unit manager. She filled out the union contracts for the band at Saturday Night Live. Nice young lady, and she said, I got a new job. And I said, congratulations, what's your new job? She says, I'm the associate producer of the David Letterman show. And I said, what is that? She says, you've never seen it. It comes on real early in the morning. But we are going to change the show to Late Late Night. And we are looking for a musical director to lead a four-piece band. She says, I know you're working, so you're not going to do it. But could you recommend somebody? So I said, yes, you should call this kid Paul Shaffer.
Oh, wow.
He just got back from Los Angeles. He went to Los Angeles to be an actor in a sitcom called A Year at the Top with Greg Avigan. It lasted about 4 or 5 episodes, and the network pulled the plug on it. So Paul had just gotten back to town. And so I told Liz, well, you should call this kid Paul Schaefer. He'll take care of it. Paul, as we all know, has a magical connection with music and comedy. So, and 2 or 3 weeks later, I happened to be looking on my network feed monitor in my office at Saturday Night Live, and there's Paul rehearsing a band with Steve Jordan, Hiram Bullock, and Will Lee. So in 1993, when the show moved from NBC to CBS, they got a lot of pressure from the network to enlarge the band, because other shows in that slot had larger bands than just Paul's four-piece band. So he added a couple of horns, and I was one of the horns. I was actually the trumpet player. He hired a trumpet player and a tenor sax player. So I basically played, I was a trumpet player basically for about the first 4 years, and then he added Al Ches on trumpet, so I moved over to playing more trombone and baritone sax and piccolo and other instruments. So, but working with Paul Schaefer is amazing. Paul has perfect auditory recall. He remembers everything he's ever heard. He remembers everything that's gone into his ears. And not just music, but conversations. He remembers conversations word for word that he and I had in 1975. Remember when I said this, and you said this, and I said this, and it's pretty amazing. Working with Paul has made my own memory better, because I mean, it's sort of the evolution of thought that when you see that somebody else can do something, you decide, well, you can do it. You can do that too.
Right.
And you, so you push the envelope.
Interesting. Yeah.
Paul hears a song once and he's got it totally memorized. He doesn't need a chart. And it at first was a little intimidating working with him at the show, but now my own memory has improved, and I know the way Paul works. He works very fast. His mind works very fast. His father was an attorney who worked until he was 86. So it just gives you a little clue into his mentality. Paul has a degree in sociology from University of Toronto. Dave Letterman, off stage, is actually very sort of sane and sort of quiet and sort of polite. We don't have a lot of conversation, but he's very polite. You know, have a nice weekend. How are you? You know, it's sort of small talk like that. But in his own words, he is either doing a show or thinking about doing a show. So he's preoccupied all the time. When he comes from the office to the dressing room, they clear the halls and they clear the elevators. He doesn't see anybody. They have a series of people with walkie-talkies that he doesn't run into anybody.
Wow, just to keep his mind clear and focused.
Right, exactly. Yeah, he doesn't need any distraction. And he works with a small group of people on the show, a group of producers and writers that he's quite close with. But his mind works very fast. He tries to portray himself on the show as being sort of a less than intelligent person, but in reality, he is very quick and very educated. Every night he comes out and warms up the audience a little bit before the show actually goes on the air. And he just calls on people randomly in the audience and asks them where they're from. And he starts spouting off information about their hometown that is unbelievable.
Wow.
His body of knowledge.
Uh-huh. Sounds like him and Paul have that in common in terms of the intellectual...
They work at the same speed mentally, I think.
Wow.
Which is part of their simpatico.
Mm-hmm. Wow, very cool. Thanks for sharing all that, Tom. That's amazing insight into the operation. That's great. I wanted to ask you just a couple more kind of specific musical questions. We touched on it earlier in the interview about your amazing doubling prowess, which is world class. I mean, there's very few people who can play so many instruments at such a high level that you've achieved. I notice now with younger players, a lot of players are becoming multi-instrumentalists just because of the economics of things. It's helpful if you can do more than just one thing. If you could give a piece of advice and maybe some insight into your success that you've had, what would you offer in terms of how you approach doubling? Especially for you, you're playing unrelated instruments. It's one thing to play trombone and bass trombone and euphonium, but it's another thing to play trumpet and then tenor sax and bari sax and piccolo and all the things that you're able to do. So if it was possible to capsulize your thought process as far as doubling goes, what might that be?
I think of the instruments as all being related. I think of the embouchure muscles to play all the wind instruments are similar. It's strings in the corners of the embouchure that it's important. It's the same corners that play the flute, that play the trumpet, that play the saxophone. And I see similarities in the fingering of saxophone and trumpet, for instance. Hmm. And there's a direct relationship between valve brass instruments, such as the tuba and the trumpet and the euphonium or the valve trombone or the bass trumpet, and the trombone slide positions. I figured that out at a very young age, that second position was the same as second valve, et cetera, et cetera. So that allowed me to transfer the knowledge that I had of playing the tuba into the trombone. And then I realized that when I started playing my little brother's cornet, I realized that the trumpet is just a big, big tuba. It's an octave difference. And I had no psychological hang-ups. I was told by many music teachers that I should not be fooling around with these other instruments. But my own path led me a different way. I started playing the saxophone because I wanted to play in the band. I didn't play saxophone at the time, but I wanted to be in the band. And playing other instruments has opened up opportunities for me that never would have happened had I only played the trombone. For instance, I got the job with Frank Zappa in a very strange way. I was playing with Doc Severinsen's weekend band when Doc Severinsen was still in New York. One of the weekend gigs we did was playing on The Tonight Show in L.A. about the time that the Tonight Show moved from New York to Los Angeles. So it was Doc Severinsen's Now Generation Brass with Today's Children. Mm. So we did it as a Chicago song, and I ended up playing the solo on Only the Beginnings on national TV. I think that was my first solo on national TV. So after the gig, we go back to the hotel room, and Lou Marini and I are hanging out with Sal Marquez. And he later played trumpet on The Tonight Show,
right,
Branford Marsalis. Anyway, Sal Marquez was in school with Lou and I at North Texas, and so we're hanging out in the room doing whatever musicians do when they hang out. And Sal tells me, says, I'm playing with Frank Zappa now. He says he has a 20-piece band called the Grand Wazoo. He says, Howard Johnson is playing tuba in the band, but he's moving back to New York next week. Do you know anybody that plays tuba? And about that time, Sal tripped over my tuba that was on the floor in the room, in the hotel room. I was playing, essentially playing tuba and bass trombone with Doc's band, and I would play solos on the tenor trombone. So after tripping over the tuba, Sal says, you play tuba, don't you, Tom? And I said, yes. And he says, you want to play with Frank? And I said, yes. So he gets Frank on the phone. He calls from the hotel room phone, and he says, he's talking to Frank. Well, yeah, he's my buddy, blah, 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 blah. And then Frank obviously asked him, how does he play? And he says, well, Frank, to be honest with you, I've never heard him play. And he looks over at me and he says, how do you play? So I picked up the tuba and played it over the telephone, and Frank hired me. So if I hadn't played the tuba, I never would have gotten that gig with Frank. We went over to Frank's house the next day, and Frank says, Sal tells me you play some other instruments besides the tuba. And I said, yes. He said, well, give me a list. So I wrote him a list. I said, piccolo trumpet, trombone, bass trombone, tenor sax. And I showed up for rehearsal 2 weeks later, and Frank had rewritten all of his music so that I had a part on every instrument that was on the list.
Wow.
So now I'm playing piccolo trumpet next to Malcolm McNabb, who, as some of you know, is the film trumpet player in Los Angeles.
Yeah, one of the all-time greats. Yeah, question.
He plays the Tchaikovsky violin concerto on the trumpet. I played with Frank for quite a while. I did the Grand Wazoo tour. I did a tour with a 12-piece version of The Mothers of Invention. Then I did a tour with a 10-piece version of The Mothers of Invention. Then Frank says, next tour, I'm cutting the band down to 6 pieces, and there's going to be one horn, and that one horn is going to be Bruce Fowler. So I understand you play bass. Would you like to audition on bass? So I said, sure. So I showed up at Frank's house with my electric bass, and I remember George Duke was there. And I thought I sounded pretty good. So I went home, and I didn't hear from Frank, and I heard that he was auditioning other people that had played with him before, people that sang and played bass. And so I'm sitting around Los Angeles, and it was no gig. And so I called Frank's house, and he didn't call me back. And I called Frank's house again and left a message, and he didn't call me back. And so I got a call from Dave Bargeron one day, and he says, "We need a trumpet player to play with Blood, Sweat, and Tears. Chuck Winfield is leaving the band. Can you be here tomorrow?" He was calling from New York.
Wow.
And I said, yes. So I packed up all my stuff and checked it on the plane and moved back to New York the next day. And Frank called my house the same day I left and to confirm that I had the job playing bass with him, with Jean-Luc Ponty and George Duke. With three tours of Europe and a tour of Japan for twice the money that Blood, Sweat, and Tears was going to pay me.
Wow.
So anyway, I never looked back. I recommended a fellow named Tom Fowler, who was Bruce Fowler's brother. And Tom Fowler, amazing bass player. He ended up playing with Frank for quite a few years. And you know, the rest is sort of history. But I never would have gotten the call from Frank to play bass if I hadn't played it. And I never would have gotten the call to play with Blood, Sweat, and Tears if I had not played the trumpet. So playing these other instruments has certainly helped my career.
Yeah, that is awesome. Wow, it just shows you the thread that weaves through the whole thing. You know, Tom, you said something at the beginning of that that I thought was amazing, and I think it speaks to the power of the mind. When you said, oh, I look at all of them as related, because I think, you know, especially as music school graduates, and we all think, oh, I couldn't play, you know, I have to just do my thing and, you know, focus on that. But I love that, your mindset, and that speaks to your career and everything about you. It's like it's possible, you know, they're related. I think you kind of capsulized it in one sentence, how that the way you look at it. And I think I think we can all learn a lot from that. Tom, I just wanted to, there's a few folks that I know you are very fond of, and I just wanted to just play a little quick name association and toss out a few names and just have you give me quick thoughts about what you think of these amazing musicians and great friends and colleagues of yours. We talked about him a little bit, but let's talk about just Lou Marini to start with.
Oh, well, of course, I told you about how Lou Marini changed my life by suggesting that I transfer to North Texas. And we have played together with so many bands. We've played on the road with Doc Severinsen's Weekend Band in 1971. Then I moved to Los Angeles to play with Frank Zappa, but then I came back to New York to play with Blood, Sweat, and Tears, and Lou was playing saxophone with Blood, Sweat, and Tears. Mm-hmm. I was there for the entire year of 1973 with Blood, Sweat, and Tears, and the horn section was Lou Marini, Lou Soloff, Dave Bargeron, and myself. And we did a tour of Europe and played all over the United States, and it was just an incredible experience for me. Lou is one of my dearest and best friends. We played together with Saturday Night Live for 8 years. And we're still the best of friends. Can't think of a better person.
Awesome.
In the world.
The late,
amazing,
you know,
musician.
Yeah, no question. And I know this gentleman is very close to you, your heart. The late, great Alan Rubin, a section mate of yours for a long time with Lou on Saturday Night Live.
Just like Lou Marini taught me a lot about how to play the saxophone, I learned a lot about playing the trumpet from Alan Rubin. Alan Rubin was one of the cleanest, most in-tune, precise trumpet players I've ever heard. He went to Juilliard for a couple of years and then went out on the road with Robert Goulet. I actually met Alan many, many years ago. In 1967, I went out on the road with the Jimmy Dorsey band, and we were in New York playing at the Rainbow Room in the Empire State Building in the basement. We were playing. It was about a 6-hour gig, including two shows with Bob Eberle and Helen O'Connell. The lead trumpet player died at the President Hotel.
Oh my gosh!
And so I'm like, what are we going to do tonight? Who's going to play lead trumpet? And we'll say, well, we got this kid that plays with Robert Goulet, who's going to play tonight. And then we have a guy coming in tomorrow who's going to do the job steady. So Alan Rubin walks in, sight reads all the music, sight reads all the music for 6 hours perfectly. Sounded better than the regular guy that had been there for all these years. And so at the end of the gig, Lee Castle is paying him out in front of the bandstand. And he gives Alan the money and he says, "Yeah, kid, you sounded pretty good." And Alan says, "Yeah, I sounded a hell of a lot better than you did, Lee." As you know, Lee Castle was a trumpet player who had actually played with the Dorsey Brothers Band, and he was in his later years at the time. So Alan, that was a little encapsulation of Alan's sense of humor. He's also one of the funniest guys I ever met, and I really miss the guy. Lou and Alan and I had a certain chemistry of playing together that was magic.
Yeah.
And
I always thought that was such an amazing section. And I didn't, of course, I wasn't nearly as close to Alan as you were, but we all miss him. And I know every time I saw him, I was on the floor laughing. It's something he said, because it was just like whatever was coming in his mind, out his mouth, was just unbelievable.
Nothing was sacred to Alan.
Yeah, right. Exactly. Well, a couple more names. Here's a gentleman who lives out in Los Angeles, but you work with him quite a bit, Tom Scott.
Oh, yes. I when I was in Los Angeles with the Grand Wazoo, there was a gentleman in the Grand Wazoo named Kenny Schroyer, who was a studio-based trombone player of merit. And he called me up one day and said, "Can you cover this date for me at Universal Pictures?" So I went over there and played this recording session, and I met this young flute oboe player named Tom Scott. He was on the session, and he took me out to lunch, just like that. He didn't know who I was or anything, but he just, and I'd already heard of this guy, so, and he was just very nice to me. Now, years later, I'm in New York, my wife is pregnant with my second child, and John Belushi had sounded me in advance, said, "We're going to go to the Universal Amphitheater in Los Angeles and do a recording, and it's going to be start on the 9th of September. So I said, I'll be there. I said, "But I can't leave town until my daughter is born." And he gets all nervous. And I said, "Don't worry, my daughter's going to be born on September 1st. So there's not going to be a problem." Well, daughter was not born on September 1st. We rehearsed in New York for several days. The band leaves on the 4th of September to go out to Los Angeles to do some more rehearsing. And so I called up Tom Scott thinking that my chair on the Blues Brothers was trumpet, trombone, tenor sax, and barry sax. So I knew that Tom Scott could figure out a way to play the parts on some instrument mm-hmm. to make it work musically, knowing mm-hmm. that he was an experienced horn arranger. So Tom covered the rehearsals for me. And then September 9th came and the show started, and Tom covered for me then. So I'm pacing around the loft downtown waiting for my baby to be born, and I decided that I would make up a fourth horn part to all the charts. I did all the horn arrangements for the Blues okay. Brothers, so I decided I'd make up a fourth horn part, so I would just show up and we would do the show with four horns, and that John and Dan would like it and they would keep Tom in the band, because I had this feeling of gratitude for Tom for bailing me out of this tough situation.
Sure.
So the baby was born on early in the morning on September 12th. We check out of the hospital and take my wife and my child home. Her parents are there and a babysitter. We've got everything set up. I jump on a plane. I get to Los Angeles 2 hours before the concert. John has a limo waiting for me. I get to the venue, the Universal Amphitheater, which was an outdoor venue at the time, 1 hour before the concert. And I tell everybody about my idea. And Tom's sitting there waiting. And so we jumped in there and did the concert. And it was very successful and with four horns. And so Tom became a member of the Blues Brothers Band at that point. I just remember being on stage that night. And it was time for my tenor sax solo. And I pointed at Tom, and Tom pointed back at me and said, So now I'm playing a tenor sax solo in front of Tom Scott. And that was, anyway, and Tom was a member of the touring band on the tour we did, and both tours that we did with the Blues Brothers. Well, we only did one real tour with the Blues Brothers band in 1980 when the movie came out. We did a 5-week tour with a chartered airplane. And it was just a lot of fun. I mean, it made a lot of good music. Yes, made a lot of good music. And Tom and I are still very good friends.
That's awesome.
Yeah, he's an amazing musician and arranger and an amazing person.
Indeed, indeed. One more name, and I know this gentleman has meant a great deal to you musically, and was kind of a father in a way, musical father in a way, but the late, great Gil Evans.
Yes. I met Gil on his 60th birthday. And played in his band for the last 15 years of his life. Gil was told me amazing stories. Gil was, first of all, Gil was a person who never got old. 70, when he was 70 years old, he said, "Hey, Tom, look at my new sneakers. Then check out this new punk band I just picked up." He had a CD of a new group that came out. This guy never closed his mind. He kept his mind open for new ideas. And he was always an inspiration to me like that. And he never acted like he was up here and I was down here. It was just like we were on the same level, which was amazing to me. So among other things, we played at Sweet Basil every Monday night for 7 years. And between sets, Gil and I would go out the back door and hang out and talk about all kinds of stuff. And the stories he told me would take up an entire book. Mm-hmm. But Gil had a very free attitude about the band, too. It was about free expression, and it was about playing what you felt and when you felt. And he would never assign an order of solos. It was just sort of everything was supposed to happen the way it should happen. A couple of quick stories. While we're hanging out back in the backstage, behind the club on the street, a trumpet player was subbing in the band, and he was very confused about what was going on the bandstand. So he says, "Gil, when am I supposed to play?" Gil said, "If you feel like playing, you should play. If the band is playing the melody and you feel like playing, you should stand up and play. If somebody else is already standing up and playing a solo and you feel like playing, you should stand up and play. Wow. And if you don't feel like playing, don't play." Now, the guy was just as confused as he was when he asked the question, but I knew what Gil meant. There was another time when we're hanging out back on the street, and an older gentleman who was at the first set comes up to Gil and says, "Gil, are you going to play anything from Sketches in Spain in the next set?" And Gil said, "We don't play that old shit anymore. We're into some new shit." Now, the guy was very confused, and he said, "Well, tell me about the good old days, Gil." And Gil said, "They never were." And the guy got even further confused, and he said, "Wait a minute. I thought you were hanging out with Miles Davis and Charlie Parker on 52nd Street back in the late 40s. Gil said, "Yeah, Miles and Bird were crashing on my floor. They had drug habits. They couldn't play in a jazz club because they couldn't get a cabaret license because of their police record." He said, "I was an alcoholic, and the only reason I had an apartment was because I was writing arrangements and sending them out to Claude Thornhill's band on the road. Did you call those the good old days?" And then the guy just left. Wow. But Gil was quite an inspiration to me. I asked Gil what his voicing system was to get his unique sound, and he said it was a barbershop quartet with one extra note added. I did a further analysis of his arrangements, and even though he said he just fooled around on the piano until it sounded right, but I did a mathematical analysis of some of his music, and I came up with a voicing system, and I used it in my album Standards of Living.
Awesome.
I applied that to four horn voicings. Mm-hmm. And it was basically, it usually had all three notes of the primary triad, including the fifth that most people leave out. And the other note that was in there was usually not the seventh, which is the obvious extra note to put in. Sometimes he'd have a five and a plus five together. Mm-hmm. Sometimes he would have a major third and a minor third right next to each other. But it was... I certainly learned a lot about arranging from Gil Evans. The most significant thing he told me was when I said, where did you get your musical technique, Gil? He said, I got it all from classical music. Mm. I said, what do you mean? He says, Prelude to the Afternoon of a Faun by Debussy has all the 20th century harmonies in it. Mm. So I immediately went out and got that recording and that score and analyzed it. And I saw exactly what he meant. It had all the major sevenths and major ninth chords. It had the 13 and the 13 of the flat nine. And that changed my whole life.
Wow.
And now my new career is going to be a guest soloist with orchestras in their pop series. I'm going to be the guest artist with the University of North Texas Symphony at their gala
nice.
In October.
Oh, fantastic.
I'm sharing the bill with Eugene Rousseau.
Wow, that's terrific.
So I have arranged 16 arrangements for orchestra.
Wow.
And I've already done a couple of gigs, so I'm really looking forward to this one.
That's awesome. Well, that spills right into my, we're kind of winding down, like, a couple more questions. But, you know, Tom, you've released two CDs as a solo artist. You, every time I see you, you've got a myriad of projects on your plate, arranging-wise and playing-wise. You're out touring and playing a lot with the Fab Four, Willie's great Beatles cover band. Of course, you're still holding down the chair and doing that great work at Letterman. But so I guess that's part of the future for you. I mean, it's amazing. You just described Gil Evans about how he never got old. I feel the same way with you. You're just constantly open to new stuff, and it's inspiring. What else is in your future in terms of projects that you have in mind for the next decade or so?
Well, my newest business is I set up a little Pro Tools studio upstairs, and people send me their Pro Tools files, and I arrange a horn section and record a horn section by myself upstairs.
That's awesome.
Sometimes I triple track the parts, you know, do whatever is appropriate for the particular style of music. But that's my newest project.
You just mentioned you did something for Hanson, right?
Yes. I did the song I've Got Soul from their recent album called Anthem. Mm. And but I've been doing quite a few projects, some of them not as high profile as Hanson, but been doing quite a bit of work like that, and I'm really enjoying working with the software Pro Tools. It's just an amazing, powerful program.
You've always had a knack for that. It seems like your mind works in that very
yes.
high level of computer land and software.
I'm encouraging young people to not to be afraid of technology, to just jump in there and learn everything you can. That's the trend. That's where things are going. Video editing, sound editing, computer-based music. I was never afraid of that. I know a lot of musicians my age were scared of synthesizers. I was one of the first guys to buy a synthesizer. I bought the Emulator 2. I bought a sequencer, a drum machine. I got involved in that kind of music from the very ground floor, a JP8. I used to make demos at Saturday Night Live for songs that were appropriate. Mm-hmm. A lot of stuff from the 80s was totally robot music. So I learned how to produce that stuff. And you can't have too much knowledge.
Yeah.
And you don't want to be obsolete.
Yeah. It's kind of, it seems like it's a parallel thing to your openness as far as when back when you were very young and learning new instruments. It's just bring it on. You know, it's all new stuff. Yeah. Just go for it.
Oh, yeah. A door opens and you walk through it.
Yeah. Tom, as we close out, I just wanted to ask you one more question in kind of an advice capacity for young folks. But clearly, you've had just an amazing career and amazing success, and you've done it on such a consistent basis for a decade after decade. It's been amazing, and it's continuing without question. What advice would you have for a young musician out there who's, you know, looking at the music business that is, of course, changing all the time, but in terms of achieving success and then, you know, just like you've done, you've built on that success and you've also maintained that success. What, if it's possible to kind of capsulize that down to your thought process, what might that be?
Well, as far as specific musical advice, I would advise young musicians to practice hard, because that's the only way you can improve. Learn as many songs as you can by memory. Be able, in all styles, be able to play those songs in any key. Learn to improvise. Learn to sight read music. But the most important advice I have for a young musician who wants to be professional is be nice to everybody. Now, you may think to yourself, well, you know, my mother told me that. Well, your mother was right. if a band leader has a choice of hiring you or somebody else, and you both play on the same level, he's going to hire the nicest person of the two. And there's no reason not to be nice to everybody. You never know who's going to end up where. You never know who's going to open a door for you. In my own life, I remember a fellow who was a page at Saturday Night Live. And most people treated the pages as if they were lesser than, and with no respect. I always thought of everybody as being the same. I think in God's eyes, the same guy that cleans the toilet is on the same level as the CEO of the corporation. That's my viewpoint on life. And this guy was a nice young kid, and we became friends. And then one day he says, he says, "Bones, I got a new job. Congratulations, what are you doing?" He says, "Going to NBC Sports." So I said, "Congratulations, dude." He says, "If I ever need a band leader, I'm gonna call you." And I didn't really think about it too long, but I just said, "Sure." Well, the same guy called me back. Now he's the producer of the Fox sports show on the TV station in Chicago. And he calls me up. "Do you think you can write a theme for us?" "Yes." And then he calls me up. He says, "I'm going to produce four TV shows for Coca-Cola at the Super Bowl in Atlanta, leading up to the Super Bowl in Atlanta. Would you like to be the music director?" "Yes." So there's an example of somebody that most people dissed.
Yeah.
That's the way your karma comes back. Just be nice to everybody. I have another story, which I shouldn't tell, but I'm going to tell it anyway. I had a friend on Saturday Night Live who was kind of a hothead, and he thought he was better than everybody, and he was always putting people down and dissing people. And one day he got mad at his manager, and he fired his manager. Okay, now, 15 years later, he's up for a big movie part at Universal Pictures. And he was the obvious choice for this movie. I'm not going to mention the guy's name, and I'm not going to mention the movie.
Okay.
But he was the perfect guy for this role. Now, guess who the president of Universal is now? The manager that he fired. And this guy would not sign off on the movie. He would not sign the movie until this fellow was written out of the script. They wouldn't sign the movie. So finally, they said they got John Goodman instead. And the guy immediately signed the deal. He actually weakened his own project. He weakened his own product for his company by making this decision for his own personal vendetta. But that's the way the world works. Just be nice to everybody, and you'll quickly find out how fast things will happen in a positive manner.
That's some great advice, both musically and personally. And I know from my personal experience, I don't get to see you as often as I'd like and get to work together.
I feel the same way.
But whenever I see you, it puts a smile on my face, and you make people feel good around you, both musically and personally. And I think it's great words to live by. Tom, thank you so much again. I know you're running to do two shows, and then you're flying to Amsterdam to do a bunch of work. So there's a You're the hardest working man in show business these days. But thanks for taking time out and spending some time with us here today. Thank you also for all the inspiration you've given all of us over the years, musically and personally. And continued success with everything. We look forward to everybody watching Tom on David Letterman, but also with all his own projects and other things that he's doing. So once again, thanks so much, Tom.
My pleasure, Mike.
We will see all of you next time on Bone to Pick.